Well, good morning, and thank you again for everybody for coming from near and from far. You know, I want to take just a moment and again recognize Naveen and the team for putting this event together. They did all of this in addition to their day jobs. So, you know, if that whole big data thing doesn't work out for you, party planning, conference planning, you definitely have a secondary career. But I'd just like to say thank you to you guys. And I think it's fantastic when you look at the room, the turnout and the interest that this topic has generated is clearly something that is amazing. I've had the fortune of being in fintech for the last 25 years. I've worked at startup software companies. I've worked at large multinational banks. And now I've had the opportunity to come to the credit union. I've been with First Tech for about 2 years. When I joined, we didn't have an analytics team. We had analysts, but we didn't have a concerted, deliberate analytics team. And some of the story that we're going to talk about is the journey that we've had as an institution in really bringing analytics into the organization, and in an extremely short period of time, the interest that is generated, the value that is generated, and if you look across the industry here, clearly from an industry leadership standpoint and a thought leadership standpoint, helping to be a participant in the industry and help influence for good. One of the things that I love and relish about credit union community is truly that cooperative spirit. And I can see that here in this room. And as Naveen mentioned, some of the financial services companies, you know, feel that they're going to differentiate themselves by sort of hiding and hoarding information, whereas the credit union movement really has always been about cooperation and about transparency and about learning. So today's event, as I mentioned before, really we're looking for this to be in the spirit of the cooperative. We're going to share some things about First Tech and our journey and the things we're learning. But honestly, I think the real value is going to be hearing from all of you about what are the things that you're struggling with, what's your vision, what's your passion, and sharing that more broadly so that as an industry, we have the opportunity to transform the way we serve our members in keeping with some of these new technologies and taking advantage of some of these new tools to create truly amazing member experiences. So part of the admission price, the cost of admission, is you have to hear about First Tech. So I'm sorry about that. But I'm going to spend a little time talking about who we are as a business and our vision and our strategy around digital and around analytics and how analytics is helping influence the types of things that we're doing. The intent really is not to spend so much time talking about First Tech, but rather sharing lots of different dimensions of what we're doing as an organization so that hopefully some of it resonates. Some of it may be less interesting, but the intent is really to put out a broad spectrum so that as we go through the next couple of days, if there's an area that you have a passion about, that you want to know more about, that you want to collaborate on, we're opening up the house and saying, please, let's have that conversation. Let's have that dialogue. We'd love to learn what you're doing and continue to share the types of things that we're doing. So First Tech is at about $8.5 billion in assets under management. We've got about 400,000 members, and I believe we are the eighth largest. No, we're not the eighth largest. All right. We're the ninth largest. We're the ninth largest credit union in the country. We've enjoyed a tremendous amount of growth over the last couple of years. We're one of, if not the fastest growing large credit union in the country. We're certainly in the top in terms of growth. And as such, we have to deal with all of the challenges of rapid growth and yet still keeping that cooperative community spirit, serving our members in a personalized and a relevant way. So as you grow and you gain scale, how is it that you can still maintain that integrity of being the credit union that your members are expecting you to be? We're a seg-based credit union, so our strategic employer groups that we focus on are all high-tech companies. We've got the Nikes of the world, we've got the Amazons of the world, the Intels, the Hewlett-Packards. So for us, technology and leveraging technology in innovative ways to create personal and relevant experiences is vitally important because our membership is made up of member or employees of these high-tech organizations. Their expectations are extremely high. They are familiar with all the latest and greatest technologies. They're familiar with all the latest experiences from a digital perspective. And so when they come and they work with us, they have those same expectations that they're going to have amazing technical and digital experiences, but also still have the relevance and the personalization that comes along with a credit union. So I thought we would start a little bit by talking about some of the things that we believe are true. And a lot of this is intended to be deliberately provocative. We believe that digital is just better. It's just better for everything. We firmly believe that. We believe that analytics and intuition are the yin and the yang of the organization. Again, when I joined, we had a lot of success as an organization. We did a lot of things intuitively, and the opportunity for Naveen's team to come into existence and help blend that analytics with the intuition and the heart of a credit union is something that we think is vitally important. And we don't think that analytics supplants the passion and the intuition of an organization. So we're trying to find a way to get those two to exist in harmony. We believe that talent matters. And as you can see from the team that Naveen has put together and the existing team at First Tech, we think that talent matters a lot. And it's not just bringing in new talent, but it's also challenging your existing talent to learn new things, to embrace the possible, to embrace the new technologies, to help them to think differently. So growing your existing talent in combination with acquiring talent, we think is really, really important. We like to talk about being agile, iterate, innovate, keep moving. Anybody who's involved with technology understands it is changing extremely fast. And with that speed, oftentimes comes some confusion. Technology should you adopt? What should you do? How should we leverage some of these new tools? So we're going to share a little bit about how we experiment and how we think that experimentation is important to the growth. I think it was mentioned before, you want to fail fast. And so we talk about how do you fail safe and how do you fail fast? Because in a regulated institution, those are scary thoughts. Those are scary words. We are all subject to audit. We're all subject to compliance. One of the things that we talk about is, there's no regs out there that inhibit you from innovating. Now, regs and compliance give you guidelines, but within those guidelines, how do you structure your thinking? How do you structure your experimentation so that you can move quickly, learn quickly, fail fast, and when you're successful, how do you then take that and scale it quickly? So these are just some of the things that help shape our strategies and our visions across digital and across analytics. As I mentioned, we fundamentally believe digital is better. We believe it's better for everything. We believe 24/7, 365, anywhere, anytime that members want to engage or interact with us, digital is the medium for that. But it's not just about the technology. It's about how you shape the experiences using those technologies that make digital better. And that's a little bit more of what we're going to talk about over the next couple of days. Technology is a tool. It's how you apply those tools. It's how you create experiences. It's how you take the information that you already have to create differentiated experiences and make that personal and make that relevant. I think everybody has seen the transformation of industries. Technology is changing wholesale industries. Marc Andreessen had a famous quote that software is eating the world. I think that guy might be onto something. I think if you look at the legacy industries that many of us are familiar with, and you can see the transformation that's taking place. It's evident. It's not that books or authors are going away. They're not going away. It's not that people aren't traveling. People are still traveling. It's how people are experiencing these things that has so dramatically transformed. And so when you take that and you apply that to financial services, big question that we have is, how are we transforming ourselves as an industry to remain relevant with what all the experiences that consumers and members are expecting? So to help answer that question, we look at two parts of our membership. We have a lot of members that are in the wealth accumulating stage or the wealth management stage. They've got assets. They have financial services needs. We have to be able to strike a balance between helping serve those members who are a little less interested in disruption, but at the same time understand that we have to recruit new members. And if you look at the millennials, one of the things, among several things, that stands out is that I think for the first generation that I've been aware, millennials are now far, far more predisposed to seeking financial services from technology companies. I remember when I first started at my first software company back in 1990, and we were making loan processing software for banks and credit unions, the idea that anybody would ever get financial services from a tech company didn't exist. Nobody trusted tech. No, you know, all these little startups, these little dot-coms, these little dot-bombs. This was well before Amazon, before Google, and all those guys were starting to become relevant. If you look at the demographics of this generation, not only has that turned itself on its head, but statistically speaking, significantly, the expectation of the next generation is, of course I'm going to get my financial services from technology companies. They just do tech better. And again, banking's not going away. Borrowing, lending money, it's been around for a long time, credit risk, managing credit risk, none of those things are going to go away. But the question is, who is going to derive value in the value chain from the next generation of the membership? So we think a lot about, we have a choice. We have a choice to invest and be relevant and leverage technologies and use our assets, use our insights, use our analytics to create compelling and relevant experiences, or we can remain the porcelain piggy bank in the background. A lot of the tech disruptors would be delighted for the banks and the credit unions to remain focused on financial services and risk management and compliance and just wrap ourselves in that cloak so that they can create compelling experiences that disintermediate the experience from the commodity in the background. Again, other industries are being completely turned on their head because of their inability to disrupt themselves from within. So one of our big thoughts is there's nothing again in the regs that stops financial services companies from disrupting themselves from within. We have all the assets. We have the data, which is probably the thing that the tech companies crave the most. Because if I'm a disruptor and I look at financial services, the things that the financial services companies believe are valuable, they believe that there's trust, right? You'll hear lots of bankers talk about and credit union executives talk about, well, you know, members trust us. If you saw the millennial slide, millennials trust their tech companies. So trust is important. But I think it's a cautionary tale on trust. If somebody can prove that they can deliver a compelling and a relevant service consistently, they'll get the trust. Then it's like, well, regulations, right? Tech companies can't become banks because they don't understand regulations and compliance. Tech companies don't want to understand regulation and compliance. It's hard work. It's arduous. They're delighted for the banks to continue to hold on to operating in that environment. Because to derive value, you can let the banks do that, just like authors have to write the books. What you're going to do is you're going to disintermediate the experience, and you're going to take value out of that. So the other thing that we have that a lot of the tech disruptors don't have is that we have the data. We have the insight, and we have the information about our members. As a matter of fact, financial services, healthcare, some of the industries have more data about their membership than any other industry out there, which is why you see a lot of the tech companies struggling, because they will pick off parts of the value chain, but they can't pick off the whole value chain because they don't have the breadth of access to the data and to the insight that we have. But they can get it, because if they can insert themselves between the member and the commodity of lending, and they can start to gather that data over time, that's where they can continue to push institutions further and further into the background. So we have a choice. We can either innovate, leverage our assets, disrupt ourselves from within, or continue to face the headwinds, be relegated to the background, and cloak ourselves in the, oh, but, you know, we know how to operate in a compliant environment. There are institutions, banks, that are hearing this call and are making material investment into technologies. So a couple of the examples here. Capital One has gone out and acquired UI/UX Shop here in Oakland. They're doing that. They're spending millions and millions of dollars to acquire technology companies, because they recognize that they can't recruit technology. It's difficult. Technologists are a little averse to coming into banks and credit unions because they believe that they're not innovative. And so they're going out and they're staff-augging by buying technology companies. If you look at some of those and you look at the investments that they're making, it's pretty important. I don't think I've seen the level of activity for banks and credit unions going out and either partnering with tech companies or, in some cases, just flat out acquiring them. And the reason they're doing that is because they understand that if you're not relevant, if you're not modern, if you're not creating compelling experiences, if you're not taking advantage of these things, somebody else is going to come in and fill that void. So the other factor that is the other dynamic that's at play right now is there's a proliferation of technology tools that are becoming available. We were talking a little bit about this last night with some of the other speakers. I don't know that we've seen an era in which there's been such a proliferation of technology tools around analytics and around user experience and member experience. It feels like, you know, that's kind of the current renaissance. Is it used to be functionality was the king. You know, could you offer all the functions? Could you offer all the services? And did they work? Well, those are table stakes. And at the pace of technology, having all the features, having all the functions, and having them work isn't good enough anymore. That's the expected. How are you taking advantage of that, and how are you creating compelling and distinct and differentiated and innovative experiences is what's happening today. So navigating all the different options and all the different choices is a challenge. It's exciting, but it's a challenge. We certainly do not have the answers. Now, again, we're going to share our thoughts and our visions, and this is, again, where we're hoping that as a community, as an industry, we can put our mind share together and start to address and tackle some of those questions. So here, I thought I would just take a quick tour through where we're making strategic investments as an organization in a couple of the different dimensions. And again, the intent here is just to provoke thought, to provoke comments, see if any of this resonates with you, and we can have further dialogue about where we're going in each of these areas. So from a digital standpoint, we're making investments into next-generation platforms for online banking, mobile banking. From an information security, the IT side, we are making heavy investments in the cloud. One of the things that I'll talk a little bit more about is we have a data center today out in Rockland, and what we're doing is we're standing up a disaster recovery site with the Microsoft Azure cloud platform. That's the first step of a journey that is eventually gonna take us to where we're actually gonna move the entire credit union into the cloud. We believe that that's a strategy that fits well for us. From an analytics standpoint, we're making heavy investments into the data warehouse, heavy investments into data governance, and so we'll talk a little bit about some of those things. But we see this as all as an interconnected ecosystem. It's important, in our opinion, that we make strategic and meaningful investments across all of these dimensions so that we're able to create compelling and relevant and personal experiences for the membership. So from an online platform, we had a legacy platform, which was, it was good, it was fine, it served its purpose. But as we've grown, we've outgrown the ability of that platform. We also recognize that we are not a software company. So while we want to leverage technology, we also are not today a software company, nor do I actually believe that we're going to become a software company. I believe we're going to be a technology company, and I think there's a difference between the two. So we have gone out and we have found what we believe to be the next generation platform. And the things that were important to us in finding the next generation platform were that it had to be mobile-centric, it had to have modern navigation, it had to have modern design, it had to have the ability for us to leverage our analytics and our data so that we can create personalized and relevant experiences, where members have the ability to control more of the configuration of their experience, where members can start to create their own profiles. So we needed to go find a platform that had the flexibility and the resiliency that would let the membership really own that experience, as opposed to having us dictate that to them by offering them just a standardized product. From the firsttechfed.com, our public-facing website, we've been evolving that site rapidly. From the timeline here, we spent a lot of years on a very nice public website, but it didn't change very much. It wasn't relevant. It didn't have any analytics. It didn't have any targeting. Didn't have any personalization. So we've been on a journey to evolve that experience. I think in March, next month, we're gonna be launching the 2016 version. And at the same time, we're actually moving to the next generation CMS so that we really can move at the speed of the internet in terms of personalization, relevance for the members. We have a multi-channel or an omni-channel platform. About a year ago, we used the Salesforce CRM. We got that implemented across our branch network, across our contact center, and tied that into our digital platforms so that we're using that as a backbone to truly create a single pane of glass through which we can not only see all of our member interactions, but that we can be relevant to the member when, where, and how they choose to interact with us. So if you start an application in a branch, you can go online and you can complete the application. If you start the application online, you can go in and you can complete it at the branch, or you can complete it through the contact center. Now, we're early in that journey, and we're learning lots of things about what it really means to run an enterprise-class omni-channel. We have benefited from value. We are already seeing that members who come in and they apply for a given product, in 18% of the cases where we're able to offer them a complementary product, they're adopting those complementary products. Today, that's very rudimentary. We actually run it off a spreadsheet. But one of the things that Naveen and his team are working on are the analytics around next best product, next best offer, that Amazon-type experience. But back to our belief of think big, start small, move fast, it was more important to us that we got a viable product to market and that we iterate and we learn and we continue to evolve that product. So we have an omnichannel 2.0 that's in flight right now, where we're taking advantage of continuing to expand the connectivity of that ecosystem and continuing to expand on the capabilities. Oftentimes, institutions get trapped in, well, it all has to be perfect or it all has to be flawless, otherwise I can't do anything. So we would challenge that convention. That's not how the disruptors work. It's not how technology companies think. So why should it be the way that we think? It doesn't have to be. From an infrastructure standpoint, again, I mentioned we have a data center. We like our data center. We love our data center. IT guys, we love our data centers. But data centers are a hard business to keep up with. Keeping up with the Joneses in the brick and mortar data center game, we don't think that that's the future. Standing up redundant systems and overbuying storage, right? You don't have to do that anymore. So we have partnered with Microsoft and with Azure. And the thing that we liked about Microsoft, after we looked at everybody, was not only did Azure allow us to have data sovereignty and confirm and guarantee that our data would reside in given physical locations, we actually ended up with greater levels of security and transparency on the Azure system than we had in our own data center. And the Azure team has a financial services compliance group. So they are committed to helping ensure that everything that we're doing in that environment is compliant and auditable by the financial services audit teams, the NCUA, FFIEC. FFIEC is not an auditor, but the guidelines, the FFIEC guidelines are adhered to, the OCC. So we thought that for our needs, that worked out really well. And I know we're going to spend a little more time talking about some of the work that we've done in terms of getting our disaster recovery in there, but also Naveen is standing up our data warehouse and our data marts, has actually already stood them up in Azure. So within a 12-month period, we've been able to get our data warehousing and our DR there. After DR comes corporate comes test dev, then it comes corporate services, and then eventually we're working with Fiserv DNA to get our core hosted in Azure. So by the end of probably mid-17, we fully expect that we'll be standing up live in two instances geographically dispersed within Azure. Cybersecurity. Cybersecurity to us is on par now with credit risk. When you talk to a lot of the boards, a lot of the conversation of the boards were dominated by credit risk only. Cybersecurity is the modern credit risk. So you still have to manage your credit risk, but if you're not actively managing your cybersecurity, that's as big a threat to your organization as credit policy. It's also important, we believe, as you look at your data governance and you look at your big data, is how are you not only governing your data, how are you categorizing your data, how are you cataloging your data, how are you securitizing your data? Just because the data is available, just because you start to organize it, just because it becomes easier for the teams to access, doesn't mean that you don't have to securitize your data. So access management and understanding and having a strategy and a policy around which data people can leverage and how they leverage that data, that's an important dimension, we believe, in the whole big data journey and how we leverage and use that data. From a contact center or a member services standpoint, we're able to benefit from leveraging our data in new ways to help us better serve our members. The omni-channel platform that we invested in, that we rolled out through our contact center, took our first contact resolution from 47% to 90%, simply by helping the agents on the front line better understand what was going on with those members, how those members were interacting with us, again, whether it be through the branches, whether it be online, really empowered that team to do a much, much better job from a servicing standpoint. In addition, sales have improved dramatically. So we've had really strong conversion rates from leads opportunities into booked products because now we can actually see those activities. So before, all of those things were happening, we just didn't see it, and we weren't in a position to follow up on it. Now, we're able to see when somebody has started an application and abandoned it. So we can reach back out and help that member with whatever questions they have, how to go ahead and get that completed. So, and then the other benefit we've had is fraud avoidance. Working with our fraud team and with our risk teams, we've been able to quantify that over the past 2 years, we've probably saved $3 million-$4 million in fraud avoidance because we've got members or non-members that were attempting to game the system through the contact center or through online, fraudulently applying for products and services, fraudulently calling the call center trying to get pieces of information. So now we've been able to leverage our analytics and our data through our member services teams to not enter into those types of relationships, which I think is another thing. If you're thinking through this, it almost pays for itself. So as you're pitching the value of data and the value of some of these investments, you want to make sure that you're capturing all the economic benefits. This is Naveen's team. We stood up a center of excellence for analytics. Again, we had a lot of analysts within the organization. We were doing a lot of analytics, but we put a very concerted investment strategically on a center of excellence because, again, talent matters. And helping bring in talent such as Naveen and some of the deep subject matter experts around data governance, data analytics to teach and to empower and to help the line of business analysts be even better at their jobs is sort of the tack we've taken. We had somewhere in the neighborhood of about 40 analysts that were spread out across the organization within the business units. Naveen has a team of about 9 people. And again, it's the teach the analysts how to fish, enable the analysts who are subject matter experts in their line of business. We're not looking to replace that. What we're looking to do is we're looking to augment that. So by standing up that team and really empowering the analysts that already existed within the organization in how to adopt some of the newer technologies, we've got a 70%-75% adoption of Tableau across the franchise, and really being there to support and nurture the analysts that already exist. That's the philosophy and the strategy that we have there. The other philosophy and strategy that we've talked a little bit about that we've employed is the adoption of agility as an organization. Agile for software development, Scrum, but more in terms of agile in the big A sense, meaning helping the organization understand that we have to continue to iterate, we have to continue to improve, we have to continue to explore. Our product teams are adopting design thinking, lean methodologies. And the idea here is, based on what we know about our members, based on all the listening that is available to us through social, through the contact center, looking at what's happening within the industry, looking at some of the industry trends and data, rather than sit in a cube and then come up with, "Hey, this is the next best thing, and then we're going to build it all, and we're going to launch it out," really starting to shift the paradigm to rapid and iterative prototyping, putting those prototypes out in front of members, right? There's a lot of really well-intended folks that will say things such as, "Well, you know, I represent the membership, and I know the members, and I know what the members want." Yet not really. Actually, what you know is what you believe to be true. The members actually know what the membership wants. And while it's well-intended, it also is kind of a trap where folks are like, "You know, I can speak on behalf of." No, 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 you can't. And we don't need to anymore. The analogy that I use is if you've ever had a home built and you go out and you buy a piece of land, if you go to a builder and you say, "Build me a house," well, who knows what you're going to get, right? If the membership says, "Hey, I want a house, build me a house," well, that's partly helpful. What kind of house do you want? You want a one-story, you want a two-story, you want a ranch, you want a mock tutor, like, what do you want? So in that process, they put out a design, and then they show it to you. You can change it. Then they stand up the stick framing. You can walk through it. You can change it all the way up until you get finished. By the time it's finished, you can still change it. It's just a lot harder and a lot more expensive. So with technology, it's the same thing, right? We now have the ability to create experiences and prototypes, and we can put it out in front of our members, and we can have them touch it, and we can have them experience it, and we can modify it and adjust it. And again, where it works, then you scale it. Where it doesn't work, you haven't sunk a huge amount of cost. You haven't spent the engineering time. You haven't spent all the infrastructure time. So that's another philosophy we're excited about. I'm actually going to stop at this point. I appreciate your patience and having First Tech talk about First Tech. But the reason I wanted to share all of this with you again is to start a conversation. Hopefully some of this resonates, some of this you have some interest in, and we can keep the dialogue going. So that concludes what I wanted to share with you guys, but I would open it up to see if there are any questions or any of the things that we talked about resonate with you. Yeah. Oh, and by the way, you get a gift card because you were the first one to volunteer. So look at that.
So. Yeah, a lot of resonating stuff there, but I got a couple of specific questions for you. So
yeah.
One thing you sort of glossed over probably on purpose, but I'm curious what you determined was in the marketplace for that next-gen mobile and online banking platform.
Yeah, so...
And I have a second question too, so...
Okay, all right, well, I'll hit that one and we'll come back to the second one. Still get one gift card though.
Okay.
But, So when we were looking for the next generation online and mobile, because again, we're not a software company and we're not going to write our own, we looked at who was out there that we felt had a modern navigation, modern usability, also was built on APIs and SDKs. So what we wanted was a partner that takes care of sort of the core banking components, but was going to empower us with some tools whereby we can iterate, prototype, integrate in best of breed experiences without breaking sort of the core integrity. And what we found when we looked at a lot of the legacy players, right, a lot of the cores offer online banking, a lot of the usual suspects offer online banking, those systems are old, they're rigid, they have a lot of plaque on them. And while the decks that they show you aspire to moving towards APIs and SDKs, they can't fulfill on that. So we ended up looking at some of the newer entrants into the market. And we selected a company called Alchemy out of Plano, Texas. The other group that we looked at very, very closely was Q2, because both of those organizations were newer, they were more modern, they had more extensibility, they were going to allow us to create the kind of experiences and do the types of integrations at the speed that we wanted to do them. So everybody needs to make, obviously, their own choices. But for us, we wanted to partner with somebody that we believed was going to continue to empower us and innovate with us. And in some regards, that we had influence over. You know, we're a large credit union, but when you compare us to the banking community, you know, our scale doesn't stack up, and so our ability to influence roadmaps and future directions was more limited with some of the legacy players than it was with some of the newer players. So that does that answer your
thanks.
Question?
Okay, here's the second question.
Yeah.
So as you continue to enhance these digital platforms and bring new services to the market, for instance, like these payment initiatives now with Apple Pay, Android Pay, Samsung Pay, and so forth, what happens is like it increases member support. And so I'm curious how well you guys have been able to integrate supporting member on these digital platforms with call center or, you know, other support groups in the organization.
Absolutely. So again, there was a lot of material and I didn't want to spend too much time on it, but when in the contact center slide, we have a knowledge base, an online knowledge base, and we've seen a really large uptick in the adoption of knowledge base. I think we're up to 47%. It's grown 47% in the utilization of our knowledge base. So by leveraging some of the technologies, video, we create a lot of videos to help members understand and adopt these new technologies. A lot of the self-help guides, the knowledge base guides. Members are becoming more proficient, and they're expecting more and more that they can do their own research. And so part of how we're helping offset phone calls is by continuing to make investments in knowledge base, videos, technologies, where members can self-serve. And so far, that's been well received. We continue to improve on that, but that would be something that we'd look at. The other thing that we're looking at going forward is how do we, from a contact center standpoint, continue to become more proactively engaged in social? How do we proactively start broadcasting out and announcing some of the new things that we're doing and getting ahead of the curve? The iterating and the prototyping and the beta programs is another way that we're helping get members sort of oriented to some of the new technologies. So our website, the new website that'll launch in March, we've actually had that in a live beta for about 8 months. So we selected about 10% of the membership. We've been surveying the members, helping understand where they're struggling so we can make adjustments before we turn that on live. With our online banking, we actually ran that through a series of pilots and betas so that we could get member feedback and member learning, and we could make adjustments in our communication and our help guides and help tools. And we're actually going to be rolling that out over a series of phases so that our frontline staff is able to support that without getting overrun. Does that help?
Call center agents. Uh-huh. So these folks, like, I don't know if you guys are doing like Apple Pay or anything with tokenization.
We are.
Mm-hmm. So it's yep. Those call center agents that are
yep.
At one point, you know, repeating the last three transactions to a member, and another time they're reissuing a token if they need to be.
Yeah, so we do support Apple Pay. We do intend to support Samsung Pay. Microsoft has a payments model that they're coming out with. So we're going to be supporting all of those. We do a lot of training with our contact center reps. We did restructure the way that that department's organized so that we're able to rotate agents through training programs so that by the time they get onto the phones, that they've got skills in all of those areas. And then we've got experts set up to continue to help and augment those guys. But we really are trying to be much better about being proactive and helping members better understand what these technologies are and how they function and how they work so that they don't need to call. That's part of our strategy as well. Yeah.
We're actually implementing an architecture that we already had a small base.
Can you please state your name?
David Gumpertersch from Westcom. So we started with 7 years ago with building on a SaaS base and SaaS foundation. So it's a little different technology, but it's ones we knew. So we went with, and the analysts I had, a staff of two, we were just econometrics and credit risk. So we advanced from there, and a lot of the data analytics we tried to push out to more areas of the business than just monitoring and mitigating risk. So we started doing more front-end business. With that, the exposure eventually said, let's do this for the entire entity. I said, well, yes, okay. So that was the whole intention. So we're building on a very strong base. With that, we want to be able to engage, and I think some we were talking about it earlier, is that you want to be able to have your members actually utilize your technology more, snap deposits, payments, et cetera, rather than going into the branches. Mm-hmm. So you can actually make it more efficient, not close, but make it more efficient. On that basis, we're trying to do the same thing for us. We're trying to get our users to actually utilize, we have visual analytics. So with a proof of concept completed, we're good, we're installing, we're moving forward. It's the same context. It's trying to get those business users from all the different business units to try to utilize. We also deliver our projects through visual analytics, like with Tableau. You'll deliver through Tableau. The context is how are you getting your end users or your business analysts in, maybe not business analysts, but your individuals in the business units to be able to use that so they're not coming back to a team of eight and piling on. You can't take 50 requests a day that are all ad hoc for 1 hour from now. It just doesn't work.
Right.
So, you know, you have to funnel it, but the idea is that's you're bottlenecking people. Now, stopping the bottleneck and having them utilize it and figure out slices by branches or slices by channel, how are you implementing a process so they can utilize and get them to do snap deposit instead of coming into the branch equivalent?
Sure, you bet. So I'll have a couple ways to answer that. So first, I think that's a fantastic question that I would be curious to have you ask again when you get all of our business leader panelists up here, because I'd like to hear what their answer is. Yeah. I like it. Because you asked so nice, yes. But I think that's a great question, right? Is, you know, as some of these capabilities become available, right, the adoption within the organization to take advantage of them. You know, in tech, we often joke that tech is the easiest part of a lot of these changes and a lot of the transformations. People and the culture changes are far more difficult in many cases than the underlying technologies themselves. We've tried to adhere to the principle of think big, start small, move fast. So in some areas where the value was very clear and very evident, we would spend more of Naveen's team's time working with those business units that were hungry and pulling and wanted the assistance and they wanted the support to prove the case, to prove the model. And then as other business teams had the time or had the interest, they would start to look over and they'd say, hey, you know, what those guys are doing in consumer lending, that looks pretty good. We'd like to do that too. The other philosophy we hold, to your point about, you know, you can't have nine people become a bottleneck for the organization, spending a lot of time messaging that analytics is not reporting. We are not your reporting team, right? We don't do your reports for you. This isn't just call us up, 1-800-REPORT, right? Reporting is important, but what we're here to do is enable you to derive insight about your business, insight that you can then take back and apply to your business case to do something new, to do something differentiated. And it's a struggle because the initial reception was, oh, great, we got a bunch of really super smart report writers. That's awesome. Would you put some cheese on my fries, please? So we had to continue at the executive level and then with the line of business teams, you know, go back and reinforce the strategy, the structure, and teach them how to fish. You know, we can help you stand up your first dashboard for Tableau, but beyond that, you need to learn the skills to create your own dashboards. Because again, you're always going to be more subject matter expert in your line of business than the center of excellence team is ever going to be. We're not trying to replace that. We're trying to help augment your ability to do higher value analytic insight and less rote routine reporting. Now, rote routine reporting is still important, but we spent a lot of time talking about that's not the model that we're standing up. So hopefully that answered your question. I've got just a couple minutes. So I want to make sure that if there are, yeah, some other questions, and then certainly at the...
Hi, Kevin Williamson with Georgia's Own Credit Union. Just curious with the statistics that you threw up there, you had a lot of impressive improvements in various areas. For those of us that are, you know, to use your analogy, in the elephant stage, and as we see that elephant continue to grow, figuring out the best starting point, what's your guiding insight as the you know, maybe the easiest starting point or the biggest bang for your buck starting point to really kind of prove the analytics strategy for an organization?
Sure. So we were fairly ambitious and we were fairly audacious. So all the things that I was sharing with you guys, that's really reflective of about 2 years worth of effort. We started on multiple fronts, which may or may not work for you. One of the biggest areas to sort of prove the model is in the omni-channel, the CRM. If you don't have a CRM, I would highly encourage you to get a CRM, because then you have the ability to really start to see leads, opportunities, cases, and that is easy to quantify and it's easy to show the value there. Because again, if somebody starts an application online and they abandon it, they're probably doing that today. Are you capturing it? Are you following back up on it? Marketing automation was another case that we made early. So we're using the Eloqua, Oracle's Eloqua marketing automation solution, where we're being much more proactive and targeted in our campaigning, and it's a lot easier to quantify the value of marketing, for example. Working with the finance team was a great place for us to also start. The finance team, you know, lives data, lifetime value of a member, lifetime value of a product, understanding the value of your portfolios. That was another. Those were kind of the three that we started with. And again, as we started to show some success in some of those early efforts, we got more and more excitement from the various different business teams about, oh, hey, what you guys are doing with the finance team, what you guys are doing with the contact center in the leads and the opportunities, started to get a lot of the groundswell shifted over to the analytics teams. I don't know if that, did that answer your question? Okay.
John McBride with United Community Credit Union. First of all, thank you for sharing this information with us. This is really terrific. Second, just a clarification. Looks like you began your journey with Salesforce, and I know that Salesforce does a lot of some of the things that you're using other tools for. You mentioned, I'm not sure if it was an evolution from Salesforce to some of the Microsoft products and then also to Eloqua as well. Abandoning your commitment to Salesforce, or I'm just curious, is Salesforce going to pay a greater or lesser role as you go forward?
Sure. No, it's a good question. We sort of held a theory of we wanted to go get the best in breed based on what we were trying to solve for. So in the case of cloud, Azure for us was the right choice. In the case of CRM, we selected Salesforce as CRM. In the case of marketing automation, we selected Oracle's Eloqua. We were less concerned that we got all the same suite, all from a single provider, and we were more interested in picking the best tool to solve the need. So Tableau for data visualization. What you're seeing lots of the larger companies do, Microsoft does it, Salesforce does it, they are a one-stop shop. They've got everything. It's all interconnected, right? Kind of, right? So when you start scratching underneath the surface, what they've done is they've grown vis-a-vis acquisition. They've gone out and they bought Mercado or, you know, they bought other technologies. And as a technologist, we all understand that acquisition strategies are great. Sometimes the technologies are more compatible. Sometimes they're not compatible. So we didn't do the, hey, we're going to hook our ship only to one of our providers. So it also gives us the flexibility in negotiating. Yeah. And so that would be a strategy that I would encourage you, if you have the ability to compete, get your providers to compete. Go pick the best of breed product. Work on the integration. Most of them are now better about integrating. So that was driving our philosophy. So we like Salesforce. It works great for us. Microsoft has a CRM as well. There are other CRMs. Sugar has a CRM. I would encourage everybody to pick the best product. Yeah.
Good morning. I'm Brianna Hume with Public Service Credit Union in Denver. I have a question specifically related to the culture change in your organization around data. Maybe if you could share some of your insight or advice on how you overcame data silos and how you collaborated within your organization.
Yeah, no, that's a great question. How we're still overcoming data silos. I'd like to tell you that there's a magic wand on that one. That one's a little bit, the enculturation changes are a little bit tougher. A couple of the ways that we have tried to approach that, again, when we worked with the various different groups within our businesses, some groups sort of had a natural DNA affinity for being curious and wanting to adopt some of these technologies and some of these techniques. So we started with them. We took the easier path to work with an internal partner who was receptive and start small, prove the case, build confidence and build interest within the other groups. In often cases, you know, some of the other groups that show less interest, they're just busy. Right? It's not that they don't want to do some of these things, but you know, where they're at, they're busy and they haven't seen the value as much. So we want to start by showing quick wins and successes, and that helps people become more interested and more attracted. The other part is to be much more consultative in your approach. So one of the things that you don't want to do is you don't want to have, hey, this is just another thing that IT is doing to the business, right? You know, the IT guys are smart, business guys don't know what they're talking about, and these things are all going to make your life wonderful. That's a hard row to hoe. So really hiring and teaching your data teams about how to be consultative and really understand what the business is trying to solve for, starting from that approach, helps. But I would say again, go find the teams that are predisposed to partner with you, show the quick wins, show the value, and then be consultative with the other groups. Do not let it turn into IT for IT's sake, or we bought a new tool and you're gonna love it. Those are hard ways to get people to adopt things. And we're still working on it. So I'm sure the panelists later on will say, yeah, he sounded nice up there, but it's a struggle, yeah. Okay. Oh, we'll start here. Okay, cool. All right, I've got time for these last two, and then I'll catch all of you at the mingling sessions. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Michael Enright from Provident Credit Union. You had talked a bit about making the difference between analytics and reporting for how you respond to requests that come in. Mm-hmm. Could you go into more detail about how you separated those two channels in the beginning when you were facing that challenge?
Yeah, so a lot of times the request would come in, well-intended, again. You know, a business team would say, well, I need to understand this, or I need that, or I want this, or I want this, I want that, right? Which, fine, it's fair, right? That's a decent request. But rather than run off and go get the data and then bring it back to them, what we would say is, well, okay, so who on your team can we partner with to build the initial dashboard so that they learn how to build that dashboard, and then what they learn how to use the tool and to continue to extend on that. The other thing we did is we stood up an internal group of analysts, sort of a power analyst team, an analytic consortium, where the conversation was, how do we better empower you guys to derive your own data? And so standing that routine up with those power analysts and having that conversation really, really paid dividends for us, because those folks, you know, they want to self-serve. And if they can self-serve and they realize that what you're helping them do is self-serve, they're delighted. So half of it is don't respond directly to the put cheese on my fries, rather help them figure out how to put their own cheese on. So the last question, I think there was one last question, and then we'll move to the next section. Yes.
And my question is kind of a follow-up to you talking about your strategy of best in breed solutions for different
needs.
Yes.
And what I'm going to ask you about is how are you offsetting the support that those different solutions kind of cause from an IT standpoint?
Sure. One of the things that we did, we didn't have an enterprise architect on staff when I joined. So one of the things we did was we brought in an enterprise architect, and then we put some others around him to really put together what are our standards from a technology stack standpoint. So we're predominantly a Microsoft shop. We've got a lot of our existing staff is .NET type guys. So part of our consideration of best in breed when we're selecting tools and technologies is we do look at what is the underlying technology, do we have the DNA on our own team, is that a good fit, is it compatible with our other technologies. So we're fortunate in that, you know, at this point there's usually relevant choices in all your technologies. And so part of what informs us is picking something that we're going to be able to understand and work with. It doesn't mean that we won't pick a tool. So Salesforce, for example, right, getting Salesforce engineers, it'd be a nice job to have in the Valley these days. Those guys are kind of expensive. But they were the right best tool for us. So we also committed in the business case to the staffing. So we talk about total cost of ownership B cases. So rather than just the B case predicated on the tech, it's the B case predicated on the tech and the supportability. And if the case holds together when you fully load it with the full cost, well, then that's a relevant case for us, and then we're committed to doing that. But yeah, I mean, if they're somewhat on par and equal, we'll gravitate towards, you know, more of the .NET technologies just because our guys are already trained in it. Well, thank you, guys. I really, really appreciate it. Hopefully, this gave us some things to think about, and I'm going to get out of the way now. All right. Thanks.